Good afternoon. We are back to learn about the central nervous system, and in the central nervous system we are going to learn in specific about the brain. All of you know we have a brain, and the brain is enclosed inside the skull, and there are different layers of tissues that protect the brain. And if you would see, this is going to be more elaborate about the brain and the different functions of the brain. First, I'm going to take you to the brain anatomy.
Continue.
Here is a component that is the most essential part of the human body. Here it contains many folds. These folds are called as convolutions. The brain is kept folded like this to increase the surface area. The brain can be separated into three principal regions. One is the forebrain, that is the brain in front. Then you have the cerebellum, and then you have the brain stem. The central nervous system, as we all know, consists of the brain and spinal cord. It is surrounded by three layers of tissues, which is called as the meninges. It lies between the skull and the brain, and the vertebral foramina and the spinal cord. We all know that the spinal cord is enclosed inside the vertebral column. And inside the vertebral column, there is a hole which is called as the vertebral foramina. So inside the vertebral foramina is where you have the spinal cord. Inside the skull is where you have your brain. So the skull and the brain together is surrounded by three layers of tissues, which are called as the meninges. The brain and the spinal cord are completely surrounded by these three layers. Now, the three layers are dura mater, and then you have the pia mater, and then the arachnoid mater. Now, the outside to inside, the dura mater is the one that is present outside. Inside, as in the middle layer, is called the arachnoid mater, and the innermost layer is called the pia mater. The dura and the arachnoid mater are separated by the subdural space. The arachnoid and the pia mater are separated by the subarachnoid space. There are two layers of dura mater. We know there are three layers that separate the brain from the skull, which is the dura, arachnoid and the pia mater. The dura mater and the arachnoid mater, in between these two matters, there is a space called the subdural space. In between the arachnoid and the pia, there is a space called the subarachnoid space. Now, this dura mater itself is divided into two layers. There are two layers that enclose the entire brain. One is the outer layer that is there on the skull side, which is facing the bone. That is why it is saying the periosteum on the inner surface of the skull. So the outer surface of the brain and the inner surface of the skull is the first layer. And the second layer, which is the inner layer, lines the brain, forming a protective covering. The space between the inner and the outer layer of the dura mater, between the cerebrum. The cerebrum is the front part of the brain, and it is called the fox cerebri. It is F-A-L-X, but we read it as fox cerebri. Cerebri is because it is there in the cerebrum. This is what you see here. This is the fox cerebri. The superior sagittal sinus is formed by the fox cerebri. What is a sinus? Sinus is nothing but a space. Because it is there in front, it is called the superior sagittal sinus. Sagittal means center. that's there is a sinus that is formed there, and it's formed by the Fox cerebri. The superior sagittal sinus is formed by the Fox cerebri. Between the cerebellar hemisphere, it forms the Fox cerebelli. There are two, you know, this is the cerebrum, this is the cerebellum. Because there is the same spacing in between the cerebellum, it is called as Fox cerebelli. Now, between the cerebrum and the cerebellum, there is a space which is in the form of a tent. So, it is called as a tentorium cerebelli. Not tentorium cerebrum, but tentorium cerebelli. All these, if you can have the picture sideways and if you read these, you will be able to understand the different parts. First, we learnt about cerebrum, cerebellum. Then we learnt about Fox cerebri and Fox cerebelli. And now we are going to tentorium cerebelli, which forms the straight and the transverse sinuses. Straight spacing and the sideways spacing. Venous blood. What is venous blood? It is the blood from the veins, and it is the impure blood in the brain, drains into the venous sinus between the two layers of dura mater. We learned the two layers of dura mater, there is a space, and this space is being drained by venous blood. The dura mater at the spinal cord is a loose sheath. The dura mater at the level of the spinal cord is a loose sheath from the foramen magnum to the brain. Where is the foramen magnum? It's there in the skull. You will learn it in your osteology class, or when you can see it in your skull picture. From the foramen magnum to the brain to the second sacral vertebra. So first, what happens? The dura mater is there attached to the foramen magnum, and then it surrounds the brain, and then it goes down to the sacral vertebra. It is attached by strands of fibrous tissue to the posterior longitudinal ligament by the epidural space. Now, it encloses the filum terminale. What is filum terminale? Filum terminale is the tip of your spinal cord, as in the end part of your spinal cord, and it fuses with the periosteum at the coccyx. It is an extension of the inner layer of the cerebral dural hemisphere and is separated from the periosteum by the epidural space. Now, nerve entering in and out passes through epidural space. These attachments stabilizes the spinal cord. So, the nerves that are passing in and out of the epidural space firms the attachment of the spinal cord. It contains blood vessels and areolar connecting tissue. It is used for a diagnostic procedure to inject dyes and to apply local anesthesia. The epidural space is where the local anesthesia is injected, and also is used to inject dyes to find out for your CT and other procedures. Next, going to the arachnoid matter. First, we learnt about dura mater. Now, going into the arachnoid matter, it is a layer of fibrous tissues that lies between the dura and the pia mater. It is separated by the subdural space and the subarachnoid space. It contains cerebrospinal fluid. The arachnoid matter passes over the convolutions of the brain. What is convolution? That is the twisting of the brain that we saw in the first picture. It accompanies the inner layer of the dura mater and helps in the formation of the Fox cerebri and the tentorium cerebelli. It continues downwards to envelop the spinal cord and ends by merging with the dura mater at the level of second sacral vertebra. Just like how the dura mater is passing, this matter also goes along with it. Now, this is just a picture, it's there in your textbook. The notes that I give, if you're going to see with the textbook and if you're going to follow, you'll be able to understand. Now, pia mater is a delicate layer of connective tissue. First, we saw dura, Then we saw the arachnoid, now we're going to the biomatter. It is the delicate layer of the connective tissue containing many minute blood vessels. It adheres to the brain, completely covering the convolutions and dipping into each fissures. As I said, the twisting of the brain, we have lots of fissures. The convolutions and dipping into the brain, the biomatter goes through all this. It continues downwards, surrounding the spinal cord. Beyond the end of the spinal cord, it continues as the phylum terminale. It pierces the arachnoid tubes, goes on with dura mater and fuses with periosteum of the coccyx. The brain consists of four irregular shaped cavities. The brain, the entire brain as such, consists of four irregular shaped cavities or ventricles containing cerebrospinal fluid. These from the top is called right and the left lateral ventricle. Below you have the third ventricle, below the third you have the fourth ventricle. These cavities lie between the cerebral hemisphere, one on each of the medium plane, just below the corpus callosum. They are separated by a thin membrane called the septum lucidum. This corpus callosum, if you see, you will see it in the picture of the brain. And on either side, below the corpus callosum, you have the right and the left lateral ventricle. They communicate with the third ventricle by the interventricular foramina. We have right and left, and because right and left, next you have the third ventricle. The third and the right and left ventricle communicate with the ventricular foramina. The third ventricle is a cavity situated below the lateral ventricle. First we have the right and the left lateral ventricle. Below the lateral ventricle you have the third ventricle, and the third ventricle is a cavity situated below the lateral ventricles, between the two parts of the thalamus. We learned that the right and left lateral ventricle is present in the corpus callosum. Here the lateral the third ventricle is present between the two parts of the thalamus. It communicates with the fourth ventricle by cerebral aqueduct. So the two lateral ventricles, right and left, present in the corpus callosum, and below it you have the third ventricle. This third ventricle is present between the two parts of the thalamus, and this third ventricle communicates with the fourth ventricle by the cerebral aqueduct. Now here you have all the pictures, you can see it. The fourth ventricle is a diamond shaped structure situated below and behind the third ventricle, between the cerebellum and the pons. So the fourth ventricle is a diamond shaped structure below and behind the third ventricle, between the cerebellum and pons. It continues below the central canal of the spinal cord and communicates with the central canal and continues with the subarachnoid space by the foramina. The cerebrospinal fluid enters the subarachnoid space through these openings. The cerebrospinal fluid is secreted into each ventricle of the brain by the choroid plexus. Now we learned choroid plexus is a branching network of vessels or nerves. The blood vessels may be blood or lymphatic vessels. It's a vascular area surrounded by ependymal cells in the lining of the ventricular wall. Cerebrospinal fluid passes back into the blood through tiny diverticuli of arachnoid matter called as arachnoid villi. Arachnoid villi is nothing but a brush structure which helps in sending the CSF into the blood. Now the movement of the cerebrospinal fluid from the subarachnoid space to the venous space depends on the difference of pressure on each side of the wall of the arachnoid villi. It acts mostly like a one-way valve. It will allow only the cerebrospinal to pass out of it but not back into it. When cerebrospinal fluid's pressure is higher than the venous pressure, the CSF passes into the blood, and when the venous pressure is higher, the arachnoid villi collapses, as in it gets tightly locked, preventing the passage of the blood into the cerebrospinal fluid. There may be some reabsorption of CSF by the cells from the walls of the ventricle. Now this is where all your subarachnoid villi, subarachnoid space, arachnoid matter, meningeal dura mater, tentorium cerebelli, all these are here. So keep the notes with you, look at the picture, and when you read, you will be able to understand. Brain consists of 1/5 of the body weight, and it is around 1.4 kilograms. Cerebrum, thalamus, hypothalamus. So these three, cerebrum, thalamus, hypothalamus, forms the diencephalon. Now midbrain pons medulla oblongata forms the brain stem. So what forms the diencephalon, and write about it, was one of the previous year question, and write a note on the brain stem was also the question. So if the question is asked, you have to write about the cerebrum, thalamus and hypothalamus, and if it's asked about the brain stem, you need to write about the midbrain, pons, medulla oblongata. Now going to the brain functions, the brain stem, which is comprised of medulla oblongata, pons and the midbrain, it is the center of respiration, cardiovascular functions and digestive functions. The pons has inhibitory control centers for respiration, and it interacts with the cerebellum. The midbrain is involved with regulation of walking and posture and reflexes for head and eye movements. Cerebellum is located behind the brain stem. Cerebellum is involved in movement coordination. It is also involved in vestibular apparatus. What is vestibular apparatus? It's something that is helpful in hearing. Now going to the forebrain. The forebrain comprises of two principal organized region, a lower diencephalon and a higher telencephalon. The diencephalon is comprised of hypothalamus and the thalamus, is what we learned in the previous slide. The hypothalamus is a homeostatic center. We learned in the first class about neurons, where homeostasis means to maintain the internal environment and the external environment. Now, the thalamus is responsible for maintaining homeostasis. It also controls the body temperature, the level of blood sugar, your hunger, your satiation and your sexual behaviors. The thalamus is a complex relay station that integrates sensory signals and relays them to the brain cerebral cortex, and it is also involved in the motor control. The telencephalon of the forebrain meaning the front part of the brain, contains two symmetrical cerebral hemisphere, which contains the cerebral cortex, the basal ganglia and the limbic system. We learned about basal ganglia when we learned about neuron. The basal ganglia is the only collection of nerve in the central nervous system where it is not called as nuclei but called as a ganglia. Each hemisphere is divided into four distinct area, which is the frontal lobe, the parietal lobe, occipital and the temporal lobe. So all this you will learn in your osteology. The frontal lobe is the front part of your skull. It involves in learning, planning, speech, other physiological functions and some motor function. The parietal lobe is involved in some sensory functions and it is important in certain cognitive and intellectual processes. Occipital lobe, which is the opposite of the frontal, which is there at the back, the posterior most part of your skull or the brain. The occipital lobe is involved in the visual function. Temporal lobe is involved in hearing function and it is associated with speech centers and important involvement in memory. Basal ganglia helps and coordinates gross voluntary movement. Gross voluntary movement as in what you decide to do. In lower animals, as in other than human beings, the basal ganglia are the highest motor structure. The limbic system as in your hands and your legs, is comprised of the hippocampus of the brain, amygdala, and the other septum of the brain. Limbic system works with the hypothalamus and it controls the expression and the instinctive behavior, emotion and all the different drives that you have. Here the meaning of drive is when you are suddenly feeling hungry, when you are suddenly feeling happy, all that comes with your emotion and your drives. Hippocampus and amygdala also have major cognitive functions, mainly in processing your memory. Limbic systems of mammals are similar, indicating instinctive behaviors common to all mammals. You have heard of the word instinct. They say motherly instinct. All this is being controlled by your forebrain. Now, this is just the picture of your brain. Important note about the brain function is, even though many functions can be localized to specific regions of the brain, there are many connections via fiber pathways throughout the brain, resulting in the brain working as a whole. This is true for global functions of brain such as learning, memory and consciousness. Now, with this we learn about the sensory functions of the brain. Now going into the autonomic nervous system. We learned that autonomic nervous system is something that happens without the control of the human being. The autonomic nervous system and the endocrine system controls the body's internal organs. It innervates smooth muscles, cardiac muscles and glands, controlling the circulation of blood, the activity of the gastrointestinal tract. Here the word tract is nothing but the collection of nerves, body temperature and the number of other body functions. Most of this control is done even when you are unconscious. The autonomic nervous system is divided into two parts, which we learnt as sympathetic and the parasympathetic. The parasympathetic nerves, whose actions are mostly antagonistic, something that you do when you are afraid, when you want to fight or when you want to run away. Many organs are supplied by the nerves from each division, but some are not. The sympathetic nervous system is activated in times of crisis. The sympathetic nerve is mostly the antagonistic one, while the parasympathetic one is operated in ordinary functions. The autonomic nervous system also stimulates the secretion of the adrenal gland. The principal secretion of the adrenal gland is the epinephrine or adrenaline. Epinephrine further affects in the parts of organ systems in the autonomic nervous system response. Now this is a pathway. Now with the notes, if you are going to have this picture and read, you will be able to understand. Next is the psychopharmacotherapy. antipsychotic drugs are given to patients who have hallucinations, delusions, paranoia and other problems. Antidepressants are also given for patients like this. So with this, we finish the central nervous system. In our next class, we will learn about the peripheral nervous system.